Begin seeing the world through dark colored lenses. Sometimes we do not experience happiness in the present because of all the if onlys. If only there were peace. If only the virus would go away. If only I could see my friends and family again. If only things would just get back to normal. Living in this way, we are always striving for, but never quite achieve, happiness. It is just out of our grasp. However, Jesus came that we would have life and have it to the full right now.
Isaiah 12, 5 and 6 reads, "Sing to the Lord, for he has done glorious things. Let this be known to all the world. Shout aloud and sing for joy, people of Zion, for great is the Holy One of Israel among you." Today we light the candle of joy, and we remember that joy is not dependent upon our circumstances. Joy comes from the Lord. Joy comes when we take the time to be mindful of the work of God in the present moment. Help us, O God, to spread your joy so that others may see evidence of your work in our hearts. We pray that there will be more kindness in our world, less materialism, and greater focus on Jesus, because what the world needs now is joy.
Christmas is very special to me in many different ways. Apart from the side which is Santa Claus, which I can tolerate, Jesus means a lot to me to know that he was born. And it's some of the values that he's brought to us to learn from that I think about the most. When we were stationed in Nova Scotia, I can still remember a little town. We only had about 30 baskets that we sent out, and we had a person come to me and said, Lieutenant, they said, I know somebody who could really use help this Christmas time. We happen to be a family where the mother of two small children had come down with rheumatoid arthritis. And so I said, well, if you can have them to come in and I'll see if we can do something for them. Well, it didn't happen. They were too proud. They didn't want to come in. So I took my van and I drove out to their place with toys and food and all the rest of it. And as soon as they saw me come in, they said, no, we don't want your charity. I said, well, actually, I said, I'm not taking this back. So I left it on the doorstep and wished them a Merry Christmas, and I left. And the nice thing about it is that after Christmas time, when people do say thank you in many different ways, well, I don't think I received anything in the mail saying thank you except for this one family. And they left a little note on my doorstep to tell me that they really appreciated what I had done for them that Christmas time. How does one sum that up? To me, that's what Christmas is all about. Christmas should be every day when we can show love and concern and compassion for everybody. I hope that helps for everybody as they think about this Christmas time.
Scripture reading this morning is from 1 Peter chapter 1 verses 3 to 9, A Living Hope, and I'm reading from the Good News Bible. Let us give thanks to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Because of his great mercy, he gave us new life by raising Jesus Christ from death. This fills us with a living hope, and so we look forward to possessing the rich blessings that God keeps for his people. He keeps them for you in heaven, where they cannot decay or spoil or fade away. They are for you, who through faith are kept safe by God's power for the salvation which is ready to be revealed at the end of time. Be glad about this, even though it may now be necessary for you to be sad for a while because of the many kinds of trials you suffer. Their purpose is to prove that your faith is genuine. Even gold, which can be destroyed, is tested by fire. And so your faith, which is much more precious than gold, must also be tested so that it may endure. Then you will receive praise and glory and honor on the day when Jesus Christ is revealed. You love him, although you have not seen him, and you believe in him, although you do not now see him. So you rejoice with a great and glorious joy, which words cannot express. Because you are receiving the salvation of your souls, which is the purpose of your faith in him. May these words be inspiring to you today.
Thank you. during this Advent season, we've explored the phrase, what the world needs now is dot, dot, dot. We've looked at hope. We've looked at faith, words that make us think of Christmas. Hope is two things. It's desire, but it's also expectation. You desire something and you know in your heart that God is going to do. You desire it and you also expect it. Considering faith, we talked about the faith that Joseph had in the promises and the leadings of God. Let me share several verses with you. I invite you to listen carefully. John 15:11. I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and your joy may be complete. James 1:2. Consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds. 1 John 1:4. We write this to you to make our joy complete. And finally, 2 Corinthians 8:1-3 says this, and now, brothers and sisters, we want you to know about the grace that God has given the Macedonian churches. In the midst of a very severe trial, their overflowing joy and their extreme poverty welled up in rich generosity. For I testify that they gave as much as they were able, and even beyond their ability. Used just over 200 times in the scripture, depending on the translation you're looking at, the word joy comes from the Greek word that means several things: gladness, delight, exhilaration. It's often used with an adjective like exuberant joy or intense joy, great joy, extreme joy, unspeakable joy, filled with joy. So the question is, do you have it? If your answer is a hesitation or I'm not sure, then I'll answer it for you. No, you don't have it. Let me begin with a simple question. How many of us, or have you, ever felt discouraged? Okay, that's about all of us. So all of us need to hear this message today about joy. The Bible uses the word phrase unspeakable, often referring to joy. And it uses it a few times. Paul uses it when he says in 2 Corinthians 9:15, thanks be to God for his unspeakable gift. Another occasion, Paul speaks of a time when God allows him to have a glimpse of heaven, and he describes it in this way. He says, I was caught up in heaven where I heard unspeakable words, which I am not allowed to even speak or repeat. Another time, Peter talks about joy unspeakable. And what each writer is describing is a kind of happiness and fulfillment that is so amazing we cannot find words to describe. Let me ask you again. Do you have it? And if not, do you want it? This morning I want to answer from Scripture 5 questions about this thing we call joy. So let's jump right in. Question 1. What is joy and how is it different from happiness? After all, if we don't know what it is, how will we know when we find it? Simply defined, it means cheerfulness or gladness or happiness. But it really means more than that. It's all of those things multiplied over and over. You can't use the word joy in a mild way. You can't say, I'm joyful. Joy is intense. There's nothing calm about it. Someone has put it this way. Joy is happiness with a much longer shelf life. And there's a key word that we really need to get, that we really need to understand, and it's the word gift. Joy is a gift. And at this time of year, especially, we somehow think that we can buy it, that joy is up for sale. Some television preachers even preach what's known as the prosperity gospel, which simply means the more you give them, the more you're going to have, and the wealthier you'll become, and then you'll become blessed. Giving is a blessing for sure. But understand this, joy is a gift. We cannot earn it, and we cannot buy it. Another word that's extremely important if you want joy is the word attitude. Attitude is paramount. Attitude is everything. If you want real joy, then constant negative thinking has to go. They can't coincide. Another word that's critical here is circumstances. And this is where we find the greatest difference between happiness and joy. Happiness is based on circumstances. I got a raise. I got a job. I got a new relationship. Joy rises above all of that. Joy says, perhaps I didn't get the job. I didn't get the raise. I didn't get the boyfriend or the girlfriend. But you know what? Life is good, and God's going to be there for me, and He is enough. Joy, like hope, has a level of optimism. Perhaps the greatest illustration I see of this in Scripture is in the life of Jesus. Listen to what the writer of Hebrews has to say in chapter 12, verses 2 to 3. It says this, "Fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinners so that you will not grow weary and lose heart." It's important to know the difference. Happiness means different things to different people. It's not always clear what we mean when we say we're happy. Joy is something that continues. It lasts. Happiness is temporary. Joy comes from the inside. It's internal. Happiness is external and it's a result of our circumstances. But joy rises above our circumstances. Question number two, how can I get it? I mean, we all want it, right? First of all, joy does not come naturally. Remember, it's a gift. You're not born with it. Solomon said, "Cry out for insight and ask for understanding. Search for them as you would for silver. Seek them like hidden treasures." To me, I believe joy is a bit like that. At times, it's hard to find. And it can also be hard to hang on to. But remember, it's a gift, and God wants you to have it. Joy is not found in seeing how much you can do for yourself. There's a great truth in the acronym that we use, that we often sang in Sunday school when we were younger, perhaps. J-O-Y, J-O-Y, surely this must be Jesus first, yourself last, and others in between. Question number three, why do I need it? And how will I benefit from having it? Well, first off, you need it when you're being tested. James said this. He said, "Consider it joy whenever you face trials of many kinds, because the testing of your faith causes you to grow." It produces perseverance. It produces patience. There's a direct correlation, I believe, between joy and temptation and testing. And we need to see it. But why don't we have it? There could be some reasons. First of all, maybe a lack of focus. You are either focused on the wrong things, or you simply have no focus at all. Look at what Paul tells us in Philippians 4, verse 8. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. We need to get our focus back. Secondly, things. A fancy word for that is materialism. Have you ever said this or thought this? If I just had that car, if I just had that truck, that canoe, that boat, that kayak, whatever, that house, that man, that woman, that pair of shoes, then I would be happy. If I just had that thing, if I just had that iPhone, then I would be happy. And thirdly, lack of perspective, a bad attitude. Perspective is how we see things. There's definitely more than one way to look at everything. Sometimes we need just a new or a fresh perspective. Last question, number 5. Why is it that just when I seem to find joy, I lose it? Humanity has sought for joy in every place imaginable. Some find it. Some seem to never. And it's important to remember this. Anything this side of heaven is going to be less than perfect. For those people who didn't find joy, they were seeking the wrong thing. Their focus wasn't in the right place. They were more concerned with their circumstances and their things, whatever that is. Joy is a gift. Joy is not seeking pleasure. Really, it's just the opposite. In fact, get this. I believe the more we work or seek to be happy, the more miserable we become, more frustrated. Eric Hoffer, the American moral and social philosopher, said this. He said, "The search for happiness is one of the chief sources of unhappiness." And I believe that. You will not find joy in a position, in power, in money, or through relationships. Joy is only found in Jesus. So, this Christmas, as we scurry and search for those things that we think will bring us joy, let us remember that it's not through our happiness that we find joy, but through the gift of Jesus, as we learn to focus once again on the birth, life, death, and resurrection of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Joy to the world. God bless you. Amen.